Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Preacher and the Mountain Caesar by William W. Johnstone, narrated by J. Rodney Turner. 1. There's a limit to everything, by dang it, the mountain man known as Preacher fumed to himself. At least that's how he saw it. Birds twittered musically overhead. A fat white-tailed deer bounded across the meadow in this lush, deep basin. Water burbled clear and pure in the narrow stream that cut diagonally through the upper end of the valley and left by way of the entrance gorge to the south. Only marginally on the east side of the continental divide, watercourses often did not follow the rule of the land. Tangy pine scented the clear, crisp air, while small puffball clouds floated by overhead. So why in tarnation would a body come along and spoil a perfectly relaxful fall? Yet, here they were, five of the most vile, stomach-churning, unwashed buzzard pukes Preacher had ever laid eyes upon. Worse, they looked to be fixing to ruin his peaceful laying up for winter by settling down in the selfsame valley he had staked out for its high mountain walls to the north, east, and west. Preacher found himself jealous of sharing the sure, swift stream that ran through the middle, and the ample, tall, slender fir trees which abounded on the slopes, from which he could make a stout little cabin and enjoy a source of plentiful wood for heat and cooking. No, it wouldn't do. Not at all. But despite that, Preacher decided to drop down and invite these hog-dirty, walking, talking slop jaws to depart. Preacher meandered down to where the scruffy frontier trash had put up a disreputable lean-to and hashed together a pine bough lodge which would not shed water or keep out the cold. Stupid flatlanders, no doubt, he reasoned as he neared. Preacher halted a goodly distance from the men, who had to be bone stupid to have not noted his approach, and hollered up at the camp. "Hello, the camp."
"Howdy, mister. Come on in and fetch up a cup of coffee."
"Thank you. I'll come in right enough." Preacher came to within 3 long paces of the rude camp, then screwed a ground anchor and tied his horse to it. Preacher entered the camp, his posture one of complete dominance. This was his valley, by damn. One of the unshaven quintet studied their visitor with open curiosity. Only a bit over what passed for average height in these days, the man had an air of power about him. From his broad shoulders and thick chest to his narrow waist, he radiated strength. The man Preacher viewed as an intruder raised a hand in a greeting.
"Rest yourself, stranger. There's coffee over yon."
"I'll not be staying for coffee, thank you all the same. Name's Preacher." He noted how their eyes widened at this news. "I come to offer you an invitation."
"That's mighty nice. What's the invite for?"
"I'm asking you fellas to pack up your gear and be out of my valley before sundown."
His gray eyes, they noted, were cold and hard. Surprised looks came from the 5 men. Lomax and Phelps grew angry at once. Windy Creek produced a snarl that came off more like a sneer, while Rush and Thumper separated from the others slightly to get an advantage. Preacher noted all of that and accepted the fact that his invitation could be a bit more difficult to deliver than he had anticipated. They showed other obvious signs of how unkindly they took his words. "Lomax, Windy," barked the only one who had spoken so far.
"Looks to me we have to learn this boy some manners."
"You got that right, Phelps,"
Rusk growled from nearly behind Preacher. From a similar position at Preacher's left rear, Thumper uttered the wheezing gasp that served him for laughter.
"This is gonna be easy, Rusk. All we gotta do is jump on him,
and haul him down while Phelps and Lomax work him over a bit." A low chuckle came from the one preacher identified as Windy. "Then we take him off with us like we was told. He, he, he." The sound of his laughter came out even worse than that of Thumper. Preacher raised his big hands, palms up and open. He took a deep breath and sighed aloud as he spoke. "Well, hell, fellers, if you're set on joining the dance, I suppose I have to accommodate." While they took time to digest the meaning of Preacher's fancy words, he exploded into instant, furious action. He whipped out with one big hand and popped Lomax along the jaw. The contact sounded like a rifle shot. Preacher kept his momentum and spun to snap a hard right fist into the bony chest of Windy Creek. The skinny border rat grunted, and his eyes crossed momentarily. Preacher followed up with a left to Wendy's unguarded cheek, blood sprayed at the contact. A right cross produced a screeching sound from Wendy's mouth that set Preacher's teeth on edge. The spry, if momentarily befuddled Wendy, began to spit out teeth as he danced backward. Rusk and Thumper grabbed Preacher from behind the next instant. Preacher raised a heel into Thumper's crotch and got a satisfying squeal of pain in return. Then the punches began to smack into Preacher's middle and face. Phelps and Lomax closed in, working with the efficiency of steam engines. Lomax, an ugly brute of short stature, pistoned his arms forward and back, pounding Preacher in the belly with hard-knuckled regularity. Phelps, tall and skinny, worked over his crime partner's head, driving cutting, jarring lefts and rights to the planes of Preacher's face. Blood began to flow from a cut high on one cheekbone. A ringing filled Preacher's head as Phelps lopped him one in an ear. Pain exploded in his left eye, and the tissue began to swell immediately. He'd have a good mouse out of that one, Preacher reckoned. He chose to ignore the efforts of Lomax. The short, pudgy hard case furiously drove his fists into slabs of work-hardened muscle to no effect, save to sap his own energy. Lomax tagged Preacher on the point of his chin, and stars blazed behind the mountain man's eyes. Preacher sucked in a deep breath and shifted position. "Well, hell," he drawled, "that's about enough of this." Preacher stomped a high instep on a foot that belonged to Rusk, yanked himself free, and boxed the ears off Lomax. Howling, the squat piece of human debris clapped hand to both ears and spun away from Preacher to receive a solid kick in the rear as further reward. Eyes widening, Phelps took a step backward and tripped over a snub piece of granite protruding from the grassy turf. He caught a solid punch under the heart that knocked the air from his lungs and momentarily froze his diaphragm. He hit the ground, seeing stars and listening to the birdies sing. Ignoring that pair, Preacher turned his attention toward the remaining three. Rusk, Thumper, and Windy Creek stared in confused disbelief. No one man had ever stood up to them like this. Not even just two alone. They had not been told something about this Preacher, the trio immediately suspected. Most of all, how goddamn mean he could be. Rusk, Thumper, and Windy Creek exchanged worried glances. Windy was known as a champion free-for-all wrestler. It seemed his responsibility to take care of Preacher. The expressions of the other two said as much. Windy shrugged his shoulders until they hunched to protect his neck, snuffled and shifted his feet on the ground. When his partners in crime fainted to distract Preacher, he jumped forward, spread his arms, and sought to clasp the wiry mountain man in a ferocious bear hug. Only Preacher was not there. "Huh?" Windy grunted, then let out a howl as pain exploded in the side of his head. How had Preacher gotten over there without him seeing it? Windy turned to face the threat, feeling ready now. No time for finesse, he reckoned. He'd just plow right in and throw his man with one massive twist of his shoulders.
or would he get clobbered in the head again? Much to his surprise, Wendy got a good hold on Preacher. He put the point of his shoulder in deep against Preacher's ribs and set his powerful tree stump legs. Arms locked at the wrist, he heaved and felt the sudden give as Preacher left the ground. Elation filled Wendy as he slammed his opponent down hard on the ground. Preacher grunted, shook his head, and let his mind absorb the pain that radiated from his ribs. It took him only a moment to realize that his assailant lacked the polish and skill of a true grappler. The ancient Greek art of wrestling was better understood by the Cheyenne and the Sioux than by most white men. That gave Preacher a decided advantage as he saw it. He had learned his wrestling from the Cheyenne. While Wendy scrambled to find new purchase, Preacher drew his legs up in front of him. When his knees reached the middle of his chest, he had Wendy humped up like a bison bull mounting a heifer. The illusion lasted only a second, as Preacher put all his effort into violently thrusting his legs outward. A moment's resistance, and then Wendy went flying. Preacher bounded to his feet in time to meet Rusk and Thumper. Rusk caught the brunt of Preacher's fury. Hard fists pounded his chest and gut until Rusk dropped his guard. Then Preacher went to work on the youthful, if dirty, face of the junior thug. Rusk's grunts and groans changed to yips of pain. Preacher spread the nose all over Rusk's face for a second before Thumper grabbed him. Thumper had only begun to pull Preacher around when he got hit low and painfully, an inch above his wide trouser belt. The power in Preacher's punch lifted Thumper off the ground. Before he even had time to wonder where the blow had come from, Preacher sent him into a hazy twilight land. The big, thick-legged mountain man spun around to see what opposition remained. In that instant, he discovered that the fight had turned serious. Off to one side, Windy Creek held a 70-caliber horse pistol. To Preacher's front, Lomax stood hunched over, breathing hard, and he had a knife out, held low, the edge up in a ripping position. From behind Preacher, Rusk, coughing and retching, pulled a short, ground-down sword. That made the day look a little darker, Preacher reasoned.
We gonna fix you for this, you bastard. You boys, a panting Phelps grunted. Throw down on him. We'll hold him while Lomax carves out his liver.
Then he, too, drew a big 70-caliber horse pistol. Faced with this opposition, Preacher did a quick reappraisal. Confronting the 70-caliber muzzles and wickedly sharp edges, he found their attitude decidedly hostile. Cranky enough, he reckoned, that he'd best do something about it. He twisted his face into a semblance of amiability and raised the distracting left hand.
Well, heck, fellers. Why didn't you tell me this was supposed to be a gunfight?
With that, he dropped his other hand to the smooth walnut butt grips of one of his marvelous 44 Walker Colt six-shooters and whipped it out with a suddenness that left the others still thinking about what they should do next. With cold precision, he blasted two of the woolly-eared men into the arms of their maker. His first two slugs punched into Phelps' chest. He rocked back and sat abruptly on his skinny butt. Preacher ducked and spun to send two more rounds into the surprised face of Windy Creek. Belatedly, Windy's 70-caliber horse pistol discharged into the ground with a solid thud. Preacher ignored it to turn and menace the remaining simpleton trash. Rusk and Thumper fired as one. A fat ball moaned past Preacher's ear, low enough to the shoulder that he could feel its wind. He gave the shooter, Thumper, a 44 slug in the hollow of his throat. It landed the thug backward in a heap beside the dying Phelps. Rusk's eyes went wide. He had fired his only barrel and had no time to reload. He gained precious seconds in which to go for a second pistol in his belt when Lomax charged with a bellow, his knife at the ready.
Some of us just never get the word, Preacher said with tired sadness as he shot Lomax squarely in the chest. A feller never takes only a knife to a gunfight, he explained to the dying man at his feet. Then Rusk fired again. His bullet cut a thin line along the outside of Preacher's left shoulder. With an empty six-gun in his hand, Preacher dived and rolled for cover behind a fallen tree trunk while he drew a second magnificent 44 Walker Colt, which he had taken off the outlaw named Hash Knife a couple of years earlier, and answered Rusk with fatal authority. Rusk dropped his suddenly heavy pistol and staggered backward. Preacher took the precaution of cocking the Colt again. Then he looked around himself. None of the enemy moved, except the gut-shot Rusk, who moaned and curled up on himself, his legs trembling feebly. Preacher crossed to him. He knelt beside the dirty-faced lowlife and spoke with urgency in his voice. What brought all that on? Come to get you, Preacher. Rusk panted. Why? What got into your heads to do a fool thing like that? We. The dying man's voice took on a cold, haunting note as he gasped out his last words. We was sent. For a short while, convulsions racked the body. Then Rusk went stiff. His death rattle sounded, and he relaxed into the hands of the Grim Reaper. Preacher rose slowly, his mind awhirl with puzzlement. We was sent, he repeated. Now who in tarnation would have a mad on at me big enough to send five worthless trash bags like that to even a score? He let the question hang in the warm, late August air, while he went about rounding up the tools needed for grave digging. No stranger to the process of burial for his fellow man, Preacher much preferred that the task be left to others. For his own part, when he ever gave it thought, Preacher much preferred a Cheyenne or Sioux burial platform when it came time to give up the ghost. Let them deck him out in his finest. Lay him on a bed of sweet pine boughs, on a platform made of lodgepole pine saplings and rawhide strips, exposing him before God and man, to let the elements do their best with him. Preacher had neither wife nor, as far as he knew, living child to mourn him, more to quarrel over any possessions he might leave behind, although he wasn't real certain about the children bit. That's what Preacher hated most about the white man's way of caring for the dead. If a feller had anything to amount to a hell of beans, and had so-called loved ones left behind, getting possession of that hill of beans always made enemies of those who professed to most love the departed. Instead of supporting each other in their mutual loss, they quarreled like greedy children to divide even the clothes the poor feller left behind. Preacher stopped in his task of digging holes for the hard cases he had fought. Why couldn't they do like the Injuns and gather to lend support to one another? And in the process, leave a feller in peace. Let him take his most prized belongings with him to Na'atichna, the happy hunting ground. Preacher sighed, wiped a trickle of sweat from his brow, and returned to the chore he had given himself. They came upon him shortly before twilight. An old man, his gray hair hanging to his shoulders, unkempt and stiff from being a long time unwashed. He was brewing coffee at his small camp in a mountain valley when the skinny pair of urchins drifted silently out of the woods and stood staring gauntly at the cooking fire. It took a moment for the old man to notice their presence. When he did, he gave a start and grasped at the left side of his chest. Land of Goshen, youngins, you gave me a real start. Don't you know better than to slip up on a camp like that? His eyes narrowed with suspicion and unacknowledged alarm. There could be others out there, lurking, to attack when he became distracted.
We got lost,
stammered the skinny yellow-haired boy with the biggest cornflower blue eyes old Hatch had ever seen.
Where are you from?
We don't know, because we don't know where we are now,
the boy answered evasively.
Now that ain't any sort of answer. Whereabouts is your home?
Together they looked at the ground.
Other side of the high mountains. We got took off by some bad folks.
Hatch doubted that. Even so, he pressed for something by which to identify them.
You got names put on you?
Yes. Yes, we do. I'm Terry, and this is my sister Vicky.
Hatch canted his head to one side and made a smile.
Vicky. Victoria, eh? Like the English queen, huh?
I suppose, sir,
her sweet young voice responded.
What's your end handle? Hatch demanded.
Do you mean our last name?
Terry asked. Hatch studied them closer then. Both were barefoot and in threadbare clothes that were hardly more than rags. They had missed a good many meals. Bones stuck out everywhere. Their eyes were a bit too bright. Feverish, mayhap. The boy had a ferret quality to him, his face narrow, hollow-cheeked, eyes close together. And he was somewhat buck-toothed. He wouldn't look a person directly in the eye, either. The girl, Victoria, if that was her name, had a precious quality about her. For all her grime and stringy yellow hair, she could smile enough to charm the demons out of perdition. Her figure, although still undeveloped and boyish, held a certain promise. She stood before him now, toes turned in and touching, the hem of her skirt swaying around her knees as she twisted and turned, hands behind her back. Her attitude convinced Hatch.
There's some extra grub. Welcome to it. But first you gotta go to the creek and clean up a mite.
Oh, thank you, sir,
Vicky chirped. They started off to the creek hand in hand.
Hold on there, Hatch called after them. You can't go in there naked together, one at a time.
At home, we never have...
Terry blurted, then paused, an expression of nervous wariness flickering across his face.
I mean, we never had to do it that way when we had a home.
Well, you're getting too old to jump in bare together. Just do as I say.
They took their turns, looking unhappy about it, then returned to the warmth beside the fire. Hatch handed them plates piled high with stew and flesh flaky biscuits.
Go on, eat hearty. You could use a little meat on those bones.
Eloy Hatch glowed with an unusual contentment when he rolled up in his blankets that night. It made him feel good to do something kind for others, especially youngsters cut off from hearth and home. Tomorrow he'd see about trimming the lad's hair, maybe scare up a button or two so's to cover more of their bodies. He might even take them along with him to the trading post, where old Rube would know, if anyone did, where to find them a home. He drifted off to sleep with these good thoughts. They held him in such deep slumber, until near midnight, that Eloy Hatch never felt a thing when Terry slid the slender knife blade between Eloy's ribs and pierced his heart. When Hatch's death throes ceased, Terry and Vicky quickly stripped the corpse and campsite of all valuables, took the prospector's horses, and stole off into the night. Half a mile from the scene of their latest murder and robbery, they paused to embrace. Vicky shivered with the excitement of their bloody handiwork, and her skin was cold to the touch. Terry quickly warmed her in the shelter of his strong arms.
Their eyes got lost in one another's, and they sighed heavily. But he was nice, Terry. If we hadn't done it, we'd get a powerful beating when we got home, Vic. You know that. A sigh. Yes. You're right, Terry. She raised on tiptoe and kissed him on one cheek. It would be all right now, she knew. It would be like always.
2. Face hidden entirely behind the slouched brim of a disreputable, soft, old felt hat, the man moved with exaggerated caution between the lodgepole pines on the northern slope. To his left, another buckskin-clad figure paused, brown eyes searching the terrain from under a skunk-skin cap, a long-barreled Hawken rifle at the ready, until his partner halted behind a large fir tree. Then he went into motion downhill for a short distance. He pulled up sharply behind the protruding bulb of a gigantic granite boulder. The first man advanced again. The loose coat he wore opened in the slight breeze to reveal a barrel chest and a narrow waist, which put a lie to the salt and pepper hair that protruded from under the dirty old hat. With practiced ease, they continued to leapfrog to the valley floor. They glanced back up the steep slope. Each tried to figure out how to get the other to offer to make the long climb back to get their horses and back animals. A voice spoke to them from the cover of the tree line.
One Eye, Bart, you boys could have saved yourselves a passel of extra walking if you'd just rid straight in.
One Eye Avery Tooks cocked his head to one side.
Preacher, by God's bones it is you, ain't it? Alive and in one piece, Preacher allowed. And I saved you the trouble of bringing those mangy critters down here.
That set well with both visitors. They let out satisfied bellows when Preacher came into the open leading their livestock. Then the one Preacher called Bart pursed his thick lips and appraised his old friend with soft brown eyes.
We've been looking for you, Bart Willer advised.
He cut his eyes to the fresh mounds of earth and stones close by. The turning of his head caused the tail of his disreputable cap to sway as though alive.
Looks sort of like trouble found you first.
Preacher sighed heavily and rubbed his hands together.
That it did, and puzzlesome at that. But the telling will go better over a pot of coffee and a bit of rye.
He led the way to his partially constructed cabin and added fuel to the fire in an Indian-style beehive oven-stove combination. He told his old friends about the five men and their actions in the valley. While he talked, the water in the pot came to a boil. Preacher added coffee and an eggshell. One Eye noted that the shell had considerable size to it and was of a bluish tint. Preacher spotted his curiosity.
Duck eggs. When I first come into this hole, I found some ducks that liked it rightly enough that they made it a year-round home. Every couple of days, I'd nick an egg from each of the six nests. Yet the eggs saved the shells for coffee. Nothing settles grounds quite so good. Now, as I was telling you, Preacher said, launching back into his account of the scruffy intruders.
While he talked, he paid close attention to his visitors. He had known Bart Weller longer. Why, from way back at the rendezvous in 27, he thought. Didn't seem that his hair had a strand more of gray in it than the day they'd met. The quiet fellow, he had already partnered up with One Eye Avery Tooks before the rendezvous. Been together ever since. One Eye Avery was a legend all to himself. Of an age with Preacher and, like that venerable mountain man, one of the last of the breed, he had not sacrificed an eye to obtain his High Lonesome moniker. Indeed, he still had the clear light blue orbs with which he had been born. The first white man who, in a drunken rage, had attacked a then much younger Avery Tooks had been bent on snuffing out the life of the adventurous youthful trapper.
Avery had defended himself admirably until the huge brute got him in a bear hug. Not eager to kill the man, Avery had resorted to his only other line of offense. He had gouged out the man's eye with a long, thick thumbnail. Howling, the lout had given up, and Avery answered the questions as to why he had not finished the job with the remark that he reckoned one eye was enough. His newfound friend, Preacher, had promptly dubbed him Old One Eye. That had been years ago, yet both men had maintained their health and strength. If you saw them from behind, it would be difficult to distinguish one man from the other. From the front, One Eye's big, bulbous red nose was a sure giveaway. Tux had invited Preacher to spend the season trapping with him and his partner. Preacher knew Bart Willer to be a man with plenty of sand and more knowledge about beaver than any human should possess. He had readily agreed, and they had spent the next 3 seasons together. Like it so often happened, they drifted apart at one rendezvous, only to make infrequent contact over the years. Now, here they were in his valley. Me decided to ask them why. Bart studied that for a while, then made a reply. Well, we come across several collections of similar trash, most been heading northwest into Wyoming country. Wonder what this batch meant by being sent, One Eye asked. That sort of has me in a hassle, too, Preacher admitted. Just who and why would someone send such unclean riffraff into the High Lonesome? Bart swept the skunk skin cap off his head and ran fingers through his thick mane of hair. Lord knows the place is too crowded as it is. He paused, thought a moment. You did say these unsavory lads had been sent to get you, right? Right as rain, Bart. I'm flattered someone thought it necessary to send 5 fellers, but I'm damned if I can put a name to who it might be. Why don't you 2 light a spell, get rested? Maybe in a day or two we can figure out what this is all about. One Eye patted his belly. Suits, you being such a good cook and all. And we got some other tall tales to tell. Just for an instance, Bart and me done heard of some place in the far off supposed to have a bunch of shiny white buildings. A right colorful sight, I'd say. Preacher shot him a frown. You got it all wrong, One Eye. White is the absence of all color. That set them all to guffawing, and Preacher set out the Monongahela. 3 mangy, woolly-eared drifters crested a rise in the fairest mountains of Wyoming. They had barely raised their heads to the horizon when they halted abruptly, thunderstruck by what they saw. The one in the center mopped his thick, gaping lips and smacked his mouth closed noisily. He shook his head in an attempt to clear his vision. He saw the 7 hills with their buildings in various stages of construction. All them purty buildings, the sallow-faced lout on his left said in an awed tone. What you reckon they's here for, Hank? Henry Claypool, the one in the middle, wiped his mouth again and stared across the wide, deep basin. Don't rightly know, Jace. There's one thing I do know, they don't rightly belong here. But we was told, the shallow-faced Jason Grantling bleated. I know what we was told, idiot. I didn't expect nothing like this, though. But yep, this is the place, all right, the one we was told to find. Whoever saw a place like this? The flatland trash on Hank's right asked. Ain't got a clue. Have you turned a pet? I'd say we done took a step back in time. Turniphead, whose real name was Alvin Wooks, and Jason Grantling stared at Hank Claypool as though he had lost his mind. How come you mean that? The slightly dumber Alvin Wooks asked. Impatient, Hank gigged his horse forward. I say we ride down and find out for ourselves. Negotiating the inner slope of the basin proved easier than had the ascent. The smell of rich, fresh grass made their mounts frisky, their tails up and flying in the stout breeze that blew from the far-off structures. It brought with it the tangy scent of raw pine boards. At the foot of the incline, Hank and his companions were forced to rein in abruptly once more. This time, a group of burly, hard-faced men confronted them. They all carried long poles that looked like spears and had funny, round, knobby leather hats fastened on their heads by thick straps with cheek pieces that had been shaped like large leaves.
Uh-oh. What kind of clothes is them?
Jason asked in a worried whisper. Silas Tucker peered nearsightedly at the trembling pair before him. Tobacco juice stained his full, pouting lips and discolored the scraggly beard that surrounded the ugly hole of his mouth. He cut his shoe-button black eyes from one child to the other, despising their pale complexions, fair hair, and cornflower blue eyes. Didn't look like any kids of his at all. At all. His gaze went over their shoulders to where Faith stood in the doorway of the tumble-down cabin he and his women had labored to erect 3 summers past. He'd managed, sure enough, to stamp every one of the brats he'd given her. How had that peaked purity managed to override his Dark Hill people's blood? Of course, what with Faith being his younger sister, the blood held true, didn't it? Then there were these two. Cotton tops with their mother's coloring and eyes. But she sure was a good romp in bed. Still, Faith hadn't had that much energy since she had given birth to their oldest at 13. That was when Pop had run him and Faith off clean out of the Appalachian country. Cousins is fine and good, but your sisters are just for practicing your plowing, not planting a crop. The old man had bellowed when he shooed the shame-faced pair off the rocky hillside that constituted their farm. Well, hell, this place wasn't any better. Biggest crop each year was rocks. Now he had to make sure these ghost-pale kids of his in purity didn't leave anything behind at the old man's campsite that could be traced to him. His expression grew stony and he pinned the boy with his obsidian arms.
Tell it again, Terry. You sure this pilgrim ain't gonna go to Trout Creek Pass and yap to the law?
Yes, sir. I done slid that pig sticker in betwixt his ribs like you showed me.
You thrash it around like I said?
Silas asked from the depths of his shrewdness. Silas knew himself to be a dimwit, due to the inbreeding in his family, or at least that was what that circuit-riding doctor had said about the whole passel of Tuckers in the hills back home. But he also knew he was as shrewd as the next feller. More so than a lot. Now he watched with a growing dread as the boy blanched even whiter with guilty knowledge.
I forgot.
Rough and horny from hard work, the right hand of Silas Tucker popped loudly off the downy cheek of the frightened cherub in front of him. Tears sprang to Terry's eyes.
Dang it, boy, how's we supposed to stay safe if you keep forgetting the most important part?
Long hours, days, even weeks alone in the wilderness had given Terry a new sense of self-worth, of independence. It prompted him to an unwise decision at this point.
Maybe if you'd come along and do some of the dirty work for a change, we'd be a whole lot safer.
Silas Tucker had the boy's trousers down and the child bent over his knee in one swift move. His belt hissed out of its loops and he used it expertly to flail at Terry's exposed bottom. Bravely, the lad resisted the impulse to scream out his pain and humiliation. Not so his sister. Vicky shrieked, stamped her small feet on the hard ground, and pounded ineffectual little fists on the back of Silas Tucker.
Stop it! Stop it! You're hurting him! She wailed.
That's what I damn well intend to do, missy. And if you don't shut up, you'll get yours next.
He did stop. After 7 strokes that left angry red welts
on the pale flesh of Terry's posterior.
All right. Here's how it's gonna be. We'll both go to bed without any supper for the next week. Bread and water twice a day is all you see otherwise. The next time you go out, you make sure you stick those fellers good and proper. Wouldn't do for wording to go round that Silas Tucker's brood is doing sloppy robberies. Now go. Get out of my sight. And you best yank up them britches before you give your sister bad ideas.
Silas added with a lewd wink. Hurt and shamed, Terry did as he had been bade. He and Vicky knew all about what Silas had so nastily hinted at. They knew it went on among their half-brothers and sisters. For them, it had never held an appeal. Each loved the other and had to look out for one another for as long as they remembered. They didn't have time for that sort of foolishness. Besides, the good book said it was evil. Oh, they had read the Bible all right, only in secret. None of the rest of the Tuckers could string three letters together to make a word, let alone read. And Silas, Papa, hotly cursed the Bible and preachers in general all the time. He claimed that man had been put on the earth to take his pleasures where he wished, and that book learning and religion got in the way of that something fierce. Only went to show, Silas didn't know everything about anything. Terry had wiped away the last of his tears by the time they got to the cabin. Their mama, Purity, stopped them and asked what had happened and what Silas had decided. We got punished for not making sure that last pilgrim we robbed. Papa says we get no supper for a week, and we have bread and water only for our other meals, Terry reluctantly revealed. Inwardly, he was thinking, if only there were some way we could leave here and not come back. If we could just be free forever. Terry had no way to know that his sister shared her version of the same desire, or that the opportunity to escape lay just beyond the next couple of ranges.
One Eye Tooks and Bart Weller bent over the large cast-iron skillet, biscuit halves in hand, to mop up the last of the pan drippings left from the fresh venison steaks Preacher had fried for their breakfast. The tender meat had gone well with cornmeal mush and fried potatoes and onions. Avery Tooks glanced up from his efforts and eyed the surroundings.
Mighty larrapin', Preacher. Course it would have been better if'n we had some eggs. Why don't you get some chickens and keep a store of eggs?
For a brief moment, Preacher eyed One Eye, uncertain if he was funnin' or not.
I ain't no farmer, One Eye. Ain't made to chase after some old Dominickers or Rhode Island Reds. Let nature provide, I'll say.
Orniness twinkled in the pale blue orbs of One-Eyed Tooks.
Couldn't be that you're too lazy to tend to some measly chickens, could it?
Preacher popped upright, spluttered, cussed, and slammed his hat on the ground.
Lazy, is it? Who cooked that breakfast to feed your worthless hide and bottomless belly?
One-Eyed patted the slight mound at his middle and produced a fond smile.
And right good it was, Preacher. I'm obliged I didn't have to wrestle you for it, like I hear some visitors got to do.
Steam escaped from Preacher.
That ain't true, not a word of it. I've never begrudged a man a bite to eat if any be friendly.
He drew up suddenly.
Say, who was it told you I made a body fight for his meal?
Tooks looked him straight in the eyes.
Bloody Hand Kruger, that's who.
That crowd is a liar, plain and simple, and I'd say it to his face if he was present to hear it. There's a bit of bad blood betwixt us. Has been for a few years now. I ride my trails and he rides his. We both like it that way.
One Eye wouldn't let it go.
Might be he knows something about these strange doings in the High Lonesome. Story is he's been up north the last couple of years. That being where all this riffraff is headed, he could be the key to what's going on.
Preacher made a face.
I'd soonest kiss a wolverine as be beholden to Carl Kruger by asking him about it.
Both guests came to their boots and ankled it over to their already loaded pack horses. They adjusted the cinch straps while speculating further on the meaning behind the recent intrusions. Took summed it up for the three of them.
Yes, me, it's gonna mean trouble. Too many of those light-in-the-saddle types drifting up out of Texas ain't good for man nor beast. They all think they're good with a gun and proddy as Billy be damned. If we run across Bloody Hand, you don't mind if we ask him what he knows, do you, preacher?
Nope. Go right ahead. You ask me, though? I say we'll learn what's going on soon enough anyhow.
Bart Weller, the worrier of the partners, agreed, then added,
We should hope we don't learn of it to our regret.
Arms tightly around each other, Terry and Vicky clung close together. Each could feel the warmth of the other through their thin nightshirts. There was nothing arousing about it, only comforting. They were too bony. Terry knew that for certain. Far too little to eat. He and Vicky were always treated like outcasts, as though they did not belong to the family. When he had been littler, they had both cried about that. Now he was too old for things like that. He had to find a way for them to get something more out of life than stealing and lying and sneaking around. He refused to think about the killing. He hugged his sister tightly and whispered in her ear,
Are you awake?
Yep. So are you,
Vicky observed with the logic of a 10-year-old.
I hate it here,
Terry muttered softly.
So do I,
Vicky agreed. Terry gathered courage.
Sometimes I think the thing we best do is to run away for real.
Vicky stiffened, her eyes suddenly bright in the starlight that seeped through the tiny window in their loft room.
Do you mean it, Terry? Really mean it?
Yes, I do.
Do you want to?
We could try.
When?
Oh, when, Terry?
Terry gave that considerable thought.
Why not the next time Papa sends us out? We could go and just keep going.
To where?
Somewhere.
Anywhere we could find something.
Vicky had become quite agitated. Her slender form trembled against that of her brother.
Let's do it. Please, let's do it.
After a long moment, Terry answered in a hollow whisper,
All right, we will.
Chance decided it in the end. Philadelphia Braddock had been of several minds as to where to go for the approaching winter. He had a standing invite from two old friends who had a tidy cabin on the Snake River. They put out a good table. What with smoked salmon, plenty of elk and venison, a root cellar full of camas bulbs, wild onions, yucca root, some grown turnips and other eatables. Yet they also kept a pouch of juniper berries to flavor the raw white liquor they distilled each summer for the following cold time. When they drank that awful stuff, they got snake-pissing mean. Philadelphia could not count the number of times he had been caught up in one of their brawls. The two of them spent most of each winter covered with lumps and bruises. And Lord help the outsider who strayed within range of their fists. No, he concluded. He'd best avoid that situation. He also had a standing welcome from the Crow to visit them in Montana territory. They had always been friendly to the whites exploring in their land. He even knew he would have a nice, tractable bed warmer to occupy his lodge. Only Philadelphia reckoned as how he had more than his share of half-Crow youngsters running around the high plains already. No need to build another. That left him with the long journey to Bent's Fort. In this late year of 1848, the place was but a pale shadow of its past glory. Only two factors remained. Neither of them related to the Bent brothers. There'd be whiskey. Good, clean whiskey, aged in barrels and filtered through charcoal.
but a winter there would cost him an arm and a leg. The soft deerskin pouch around his neck still hung with respectable weight, but the gold would be soon gone at Bent's. Better pass that up for another day. Which brought him to his final choice. He could head southeast and check out the fairest mountains in Wyoming. If that didn't suit and the weather held, he could go on south to Trout Creek Pass. There, he had heard, some of the good old boys had taken to hanging out over the cold months. He could jaw a little, play cards and checkers, and have a warm bunk to roll up in at night. No pliable crow girl, nor any hard floozy for that matter, but a comfort to a man getting on in his years. By jing, that's just what he would do. Check out the rumors about a man willing to pay out real gold for fighting men in the fairest range. Then, if it didn't pan out, he'd go on to Colorado country and the High Lonesome. He might even run into his old sometime partner, Preacher. Well, with the fur trade all but moribund, Preacher and some of the old boys had taken to hanging a mite closer to civilized living. Might be he could benefit by that, too. Philadelphia Braddock clucked to his pack horse and yanked on the rope around its neck. Long ride to Trout Creek, but only a day or two now to this outfit in the Ferris Mountains. He'd give them a look-see. That's what he'd do. 3 days later, in a wide valley set off by 7 low hills, Philadelphia Braddock stumbled upon a sight he could not believe. Alabaster buildings shined from the crests of several of the 7 hills that clustered in the upland vale. It became obvious to Philadelphia that some serious construction work was going on along the slopes of the 3 still vacant hills. Flat, layered, plain trees had replaced the usual aspen, and tall, slender pines, of a blue-gray color Philadelphia had never seen before, lined a wide white cobblestone roadway that led from the south end of the basin to tall gates in what looked like a plastered stone wall that surrounded a portion of the 4 occupied hills. From his angle, Philadelphia could not tell if the rampart ran all the way around. This was one wing ding of a puzzler. He had never heard of any settlement sprouting up in the Ferris Mountains. Certainly nothing like this. Why, it was a regular city. I'll be blessed, he said aloud to his horse. The animal replied with a snort and shake of its massive head. A spray of slobber put diamonds in the air. A peremptory stomp of a hoof drew Philadelphia's attention to a knot of men who broke off from the workers, one of them pointing in his direction. Too far off to see details, the former trapper decided to wait them out. When they drew nearer, he noted that the men wore bright red capotes. No, he corrected himself. Longer than the ubiquitous mountain man garb, more like cloaks. A horseman joined them. Odd-looking fellers, Braddock advised his mount, while he patted the visibly nervous beast with one hand to calm it. When they came even closer, he saw that they wore overskirts of leather strips, studded with brass knobs. Below that, they wore short skirts. For a giddy moment, Philadelphia wondered if they might be sissies. On their heads, they had brown leather-covered pots of some sort. Odder still, he noted, they carried lances and shields like Injuns. He changed his examination of the approaching men to the one on horseback. Wasn't he a sight? He had an even longer capote, scarlet in color, with shiny brass coverings on his legs, chest, and helmet. For that's what it was, bright red roach of horsehair and all. The polished cheek pieces were shaped something like oak leaves. Then Philadelphia made out another feller, who jogged along behind the horse. He held some sort of long pole with a big metal banner on top. On closer examination, Braddock saw that it was an eagle with spread wings, head turned in profile, and something written under it. Now,
Old Philadelphia wasn't too strong on reading, but he could make out his letter as good as any man. These read S-P-Q-R. Within seconds, the rider reined up right close to Philadelphia, rudely crowding his space. He pulled a short, leaf-bladed sword and pointed it somewhere above Braddock's head. "Hold there, barbarian!" the man bellowed with all the officiousness of a government man in a swallowtail coat. "What business have you in Nova Roma?" From habit, Philadelphia made the plain sign for coming in peace as he spoke. "I was only looking for a place to hold up for winter, and I ain't no barbarian." Glowering, the challenger proved arrogant enough to not need to consult anyone about his opinion. "This is not the place. Unless you bear a scroll of safe passage, you are trespassing on the territory of Nova Roma." Philadelphia's forehead furrowed. "I ain't got no paper on me." His interrogator motioned two men forward with his sword as he spoke. "Then you are under arrest. You will be put to work with the rest of the slaves to build our magnificent city." Philadelphia Braddock did not like that one bit. His eyes narrowed. "Is that so? How long do you reckon I'll be doing that?" "Until you prove your worth to be a citizen of Nova Roma." "That long, huh?" Philadelphia followed his first instinct. His reins given a turn around the saddle horn, Braddock moved swiftly, hands closing around the handstocks of a brace of 64 caliber Chambers horse pistols. He yanked them free before any of the startled soldiers could react. The muzzles centered on the two closest to him, and he blazed away. Loud, flat reports shattered the bird-twittering silence, and twin smoke clouds obscured everything for a moment. His action served his purpose, Philadelphia observed as the greasy gray mass whipped away on a light breeze. The two who were to arrest him lay on the ground, writhing, shot X-Ys through their right shoulders. The footmen had scattered and the snarling leader had been put to flight. "Appears to me you need a lesson in manners, fellers," Braddock told them. Satisfied with the results, Philadelphia reholstered the discharged pistols and slid his hawk and rifle free of its scabbard. With a final careful appraisal of his would-be foe, he turned the head of his mount to the south and started off, away from this inhospitable place. By then, one of the footmen had recovered himself enough to spring up on his sandals and cock his arm, the hand holding his pilum behind his right ear. He let the spear fly with deadly accuracy. Sharp pain radiated through Braddock's right shoulder as the smooth point penetrated flesh and bone and pinned his shoulder blade to his ribs. Stunned by the sudden, enormous pain, Philadelphia nevertheless managed to swivel at the hips and bring up his hawken. Leveled on his assailant's chest, Braddock cocked and triggered the weapon. The big, fat 56 caliber conical bullet smashed through the soldier's sternum and ripped a big hole in his aorta. His sandals left the ground, and he crashed backward head over heels to sprawl in the dirt. His valiant heart rapidly pumped the life from his body. Philadelphia Braddock did not want to check his results, though. He put boot heels to the heaving flanks of his mount and sprinted for the distant pass that opened on the white cobblestone roadway. With each thud of a hoof, new agony shot through Philadelphia's body. The lance flopped wildly up and down, caught in his muscular back. He did not stop, though, until safely beyond the crest of the ridge. Then he scabbarded his hawken and painfully wrenched the pilum from the wound it had made.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.